There are many reasons that people do IVF or in vitro fertilization, and some of them are going to surprise you. Most people assume it's just for a fertility reason and that usually it's the woman's fault. But there are many reasons that people can use this technology to help them build a family. I hope that by learning these different reasons, people will have a better understanding and there'll be less assumptions about this incredible technology. I'm Dr. Laura Shaheen. I'm a double board certified OBGYN and reproductive endocrinologist practicing in Seattle. And I've been helping people with IVF for over 20 years. I love educating. I'm so glad you found this channel. Be sure and subscribe so you get my weekly videos all about reproductive health. There's two more ways to stay in touch and to learn. Number one, sign up for my newsletter. You get a weekly newsletter about fertility information in the news, my weekly content. And the other way is my podcast. I'm so proud of it. The Baby or Bust Fertility Podcast. Each episode comes out every single week with interviews and in-depth discussions all about reproductive health. And I'll put the link for my newsletter and the podcast in the description below. There's so many assumptions when it comes to fertility and fertility treatment, especially IVF. Very common assumption is that people are doing IVF because they can't get pregnant. They want to have a baby. And I'm sure it's a woman's fault. There's so many different reasons that people use this technology, and I can't wait to share them with you. Today, we're going to go over three main topics. Topic number one, we're going to do a refresher of IVF so you understand exactly what I'm talking about. Number two, we're going to go over the fertility reasons that people use IVF and make sure it's clear. And number three, we're going to go over the non-fertility reasons or other reasons that people could use this technology in order to build their family. And I'm excited to share this with you. Stick around to the end where I'll share some resources and some really important tips about IVF. Topic number one, what is IVF? IVF is in vitro fertilization. It's a technology that has helped people build their families for almost 50 years. Louise Brown, the first IVF baby, was born in England in 1978. And since then, millions of babies have been born with this technology. At its core, in vitro fertilization is fertilizing an egg and sperm in the lab in vitro, outside of the body, watching the embryo develop and grow, and then when the embryo is ready, putting it back into the uterus for implantation and pregnancy. So in vitro fertilization, in general, most of the time, women receive medications that help stimulate and grow multiple eggs. The eggs are retrieved from the ovaries in a procedure called an egg retrieval. In the lab, the eggs and sperm are fertilized. There's different ways that that can happen, but that fertilized egg or embryo develops in the lab, and when it's ready, whether it's a couple of days after the egg retrieval, or if the embryo has been frozen for a couple of days, up to years, that embryo can be thawed and transferred into the uterus to be implanted, cause a pregnancy, and a beautiful baby. At its core, that is what IVF is, or in vitro fertilization. Topic number two, what are the fertility factors that people would need to do IVF in order to have a baby? Well, I think about female fertility factors, male fertility factors, and then combined, you know, a couple is having difficulty conceiving, and so they'll use IVF as a way to build their family. For a female factor, the main female factor and the reason that IVF was invented over almost 50 years ago is tubal disease. So if the tubes are blocked for any reason, they're scarred, or sometimes people have had to have their tubes removed, or if the tubes are not open or they're just absent, the egg and sperm cannot find each other. So when we usually get pregnant, the egg ovulates from the ovary and goes into the fallopian tube, and that's where it meets the sperm that comes up through the reproductive tract into the fallopian tube. Fertilization happens within the fallopian tube, and that embryo comes down the fallopian tube and implants into the uterine cavity. So that is how it happens in the human body. But if the tubes are blocked, people can be ovulating and have lots of eggs, there could be lots of sperm, but they will not be able to find each other. So at its core, in vitro fertilization is doing what usually happens in the fallopian tube in the lab. So the egg and sperm are finding each other, fertilizing, embryo growing those first couple of days. And then when the embryo is ready, it can implant into the uterine cavity. I tell people it's like what's typically happening inside the body. It's just happening in the lab. And then when the embryo is ready, we're going through a different door. So instead of the embryo coming down into the uterine cavity through the fallopian tubes, it's coming up through the cervix in a procedure that we call an embryo transfer. So the one female factor that you would have to do IVF in order to have a baby is if you had blocked or missing fallopian tubes. What about a male factor? Well, if someone has really, really low sperm counts, or maybe they have sperm in the testicles, but there's no way for the sperm to come out of the body. If they are missing that tube called the vas deferens that connects the testicle to the outside of the body, they've got sperm in the testicle, but it just can't come out. That's called obstructive azoospermia. We need to extract sperm, or maybe there is sperm in the ejaculate, but just a really, really low count. Sometimes there is not enough sperm to even do an intrauterine insemination. So that is why doing a semen analysis early in your fertility journey is so important, because people can have, you know, no symptoms whatsoever, performing okay, everything feels fine, but you look under the microscope and there is very little sperm, and it can take millions and millions of sperm, even with a low-tech treatment like an intrauterine insemination, to help with fertilization inside the body. But with the technology of IVF, if you get 10 eggs from the female partner, all you need are 10 sperm to help with fertilization. And what's an amazing technology is a way to actively help fertilization that's called ICSI, intracytoplasmic sperm injection. So men with very, very low counts can have a genetic child with the help of IVF, and then this way to help fertilize the eggs and sperm called ICSI, or intracytoplasmic sperm injection. So that is a male factor where IVF, or the process of helping fertilization happen in the lab, is really required. Now, fertility factors that kind of impact both, or kind of combined fertility reasons that people might use IVF as a way to build their family, is it could be a combination of things. You know, I really think that as long as someone's ovulating, there's adequate sperm, and at least one fallopian tube is open, that it could always happen. But for some people, it's just not happening. So for unexplained infertility, all the testing is reassuring, but they're just not getting pregnant. Sometimes people will go straight to IVF. Other times people might try low-tech treatment like intrauterine inseminations. But if those aren't working, people will go to IVF to have their family. There are some fertility diagnoses that are not in isolation a reason to do IVF, but oftentimes people who have PCOS, or polycystic ovarian syndrome, or endometriosis, a chronic inflammatory condition that's associated with painful periods and sometimes difficulty getting pregnant, or maybe borderline sperm counts. So in these scenarios, like, I would never say that just having PCOS that you would have to do IVF in order to have a baby, or just because you have endometriosis, you have to do IVF in order to have a baby. But sometimes people who are struggling to conceive, they have been trying for a long time, they meet this definition of infertility, they often have other diagnoses that go along. Does that make sense? So there are fertility factors that people will use IVF in order to get pregnant and have a baby. But it's often not in isolation. It's often a combination of things. And the reason IVF is so successful, and it is a fertility treatment option that has a higher success rate than low-tech treatment, like just taking Clomid or using an intrauterine insemination, is it just controls more variables. By stimulating the ovaries, you've got multiple eggs available. You're watching the eggs and sperm fertilize. Not every egg and not every sperm is it going to become a beautiful embryo. That process of elimination and selecting for embryos that have the highest chance of implantation, it just controls for some variables that you might not be able to diagnose. I think some people have a fertilization issue. Their sperm can look beautiful under the microscope, but it's just not going to fertilize the egg on its own. Or the egg looks beautiful under the microscope, but there's just a hard shell around it. It won't let any sperm in. I think sometimes IVF can not only help people get pregnant, but it can also overcome variables that we just don't know. And sometimes you can figure things out along the way when you're doing IVF. But just wanted to kind of clarify, the most common reason that people do IVF is fertility related. And I wanted to make sure that we covered those. But topic number three are non-fertility related reasons that people do IVF. And this you might find really interesting. So there really are five things that I can think of that my patients are doing IVF, and it's not necessarily infertility related. Number one, recurrent pregnancy loss. So what this means is I do have patients that conceive very easily. They get pregnant very easily within 1 to 2 to 3 cycles, but they just keep having miscarriages. The most common cause of miscarriage is a chromosome imbalance within the embryo. And so IVF has an option called pre-implantation genetic testing for aneuploidy, PGTA, that can allow us to make sure the chromosomes are balanced, and it can decrease the risk of miscarriage. So people say, gosh, I mean, I'm getting pregnant. Why would I need to do IVF? I'm not infertile. I'm getting pregnant. But this is an option. If someone's having recurrent miscarriage for this reason, you can use IVF as an embryo selection tool to decrease the risk of another miscarriage from this one specific reason. It is not perfect. Not everyone that has recurrent miscarriages needs to do IVF to have their family. It is just something that is discussed. Some of my patients have opted for, and it is a reason that people sometimes do IVF. Non-fertility related reason number two that people do IVF are genetic mutations. Some people carry genetic mutations for diseases that they don't want to pass on. This could be cystic fibrosis. It could be thalassemia. It could be muscular dystrophy, spinal muscular atrophy. Whenever I'm meeting patients who are planning to have a baby together, whether they're doing low-tech or high-tech fertility treatment, I offer carrier screening. What this is looking for mutations in the people that are getting pregnant to see if they're at risk of passing something on to their baby. Because people can not have cystic fibrosis. No one in their family has cystic fibrosis. But if they carry that mutation and their partner also carries that mutation, there's a 25% chance that when they have a baby together, that baby could have that disease. And cystic fibrosis can be a really difficult disease to struggle with, in and out of the hospital, difficulty breathing, lung infections, and more. And it's optional to do carrier screening. I often say to my patients, we're not testing fertility. We're not testing for miscarriage risk. I'm seeing two people, and as part of preconception counseling, I want to offer to you carrier screening to see if there's anything to look for. And it's actually very rare. Most people do not share mutations, but I do have people coming to my practice that had a baby with spinal muscular atrophy, cystic fibrosis, and that's how they figured out that they carried these mutations, and they're planning to do IVF in order to not pass it on again. Non-fertility reason number three people do IVF is in order to preserve their fertility. So for example, in the setting of a cancer diagnosis, someone could get recommended to do chemotherapy or radiation therapy, and these treatments can really harm both sperm and egg health in the future. And especially for eggs, if your eggs are exposed to chemotherapy or radiation therapy, there's a chance that you could go into menopause. There's a chance that you could drastically lose your egg supply, and you might not be fertile in the future when you've recovered from your cancer treatment. And so oftentimes people get a cancer diagnosis before they do the treatment that's going to help cure their cancer. They will be offered the ability to do IVF to extract eggs. And sometimes you freeze eggs, or they would also learn about the option to create embryos. So doing IVF, extracting eggs, whether you're freezing eggs or embryos, as a part of fertility preservation, it's happening in the setting of a cancer diagnosis. So this fertility preservation in the setting of a cancer diagnosis, this could also be fertility preservation for any reason. And a lot of people are learning about the option of, say, egg freezing, to freeze eggs when you're younger in case you have fertility struggles later in life. that you have these younger eggs that you could use later in order to have your family, because age and fertility is related to the age of the eggs. And if you could freeze eggs when you're younger, if you need them later in life, you're so happy that you have them. Non-fertility related reason number four to do IVF is family planning, or using IVF as a strategy, because some people find their person in their late 30s or early 40s. They know that they want to have more than one child, maybe two or three, and they realize that age and fertility is intimately related. And so they will opt for IVF sooner rather than later, not only to have the highest chance of getting pregnant in the present day, but also freezing embryos or eggs to use in the future if they do want to have a sibling. Because if you conceive with eggs that are 40 years old, awesome, that is wonderful. But you're pregnant for a year and then you don't want, you usually try for a year after that. And trying again at 42 or 43 can be significantly harder. There really is a drop off as you get into your 40s with the ability to conceive without assistance. And sometimes IVF isn't successful, of course, as eggs age. So sometimes people will kind of think about using IVF to not only conceive now, but preserve their fertility in the future if they want to add to their family. And non-fertility related reason number five, people will do IVF is in the setting where they cannot carry a pregnancy themselves. So if someone does not have a uterus for whatever reason, or they have a chronic medical condition that will not allow them to safely carry a pregnancy, could be heart issue, could be kidney issue, could be liver function, they can go through IVF and we can extract eggs, we can create embryos in the lab, but they've been told by their doctor it is too risky on their body to go through all of the changes that have to happen to be pregnant. And so they have embryos placed into a gestational carrier, and it's an incredible gift, and they can have their family. But the only way that you can use a gestational carrier is if you go through IVF in order to collect the eggs and the sperm, create the embryo. The embryo is outside of the body, and then we're able to put that embryo into a gestational carrier to help this family be complete. So we have gone over so many reasons that people do IVF. Of course, there are fertility reasons. We talked about female reasons, male reasons, and kind of combined fertility issues, what IVF can be helpful. And then we talked about five non-fertility or infertility related reasons that people could opt for IVF as a way to build their family. I hope that this was helpful. I'm glad you stuck around because there's so much to learn about IVF. I have a whole playlist here all about IVF. I go through timelines. I go through tips for shots and medications. I go through things that I wish I knew before I did IVF myself. I learned so much going through the process myself to build my own family. And I really, really hope that these resources are helpful for you because it can be overwhelming. IVF is an incredible way to build a family, but all of a sudden you're a patient, you're a nurse, you're a pharmacist, you are, you know, it's a part-time job. You're pulling all this together. You're a financial advisor. And at the same time, you're a patient and you're struggling to build your family. So IVF is amazing. It's incredible, but there's so much to learn. And I truly hope that my educational material will help you. Like this video if you learned something, comment with questions that you have, be sure and subscribe to this channel so you get my weekly reproductive health videos. And until next week, I'm wishing you love, luck, and pineapples.